Amen indeed. Good morning, church. We are so glad you're here, whether you are a longtime member or a first-time guest. We are glad that you are here, and we hope that you have an encounter with our risen Savior and Lord. Today is Father's Day, so happy Father's Day to all those fathers who are among us. Also, if you are a father, or let me just say, if you are a living, breathing human being, that's a threshold. If you did not get donuts before church, if you'll go around the corner in an adult Sunday school class hallway, there are plenty of donuts for dad, so please get those after worship today. I want to just lift up to all of you the bulletin that you hopefully got when you came in the door. Inside that bulletin is a tear-off slip known as our connection card, and so we hope that you will let us know if you have any updates to joys or concerns in your prayer life. Let those know, put those on the connection card. Also, if you are new to us or if you're a longtime member who has maybe a new address or phone number, you can put that information on that connection card as well, and then you can turn that connection card in with the offering plate when the offering plates are passed along later on in worship. Again, we are glad that you're here, and we hope that you have a connection with the risen Lord today. I do have three brief announcements. There's a lot of things going on in the life of the church. It's summertime, but the ministry continues. One of the things that's going on, and that all of you are a lot more familiar with than I am, but the annual Odessa Fandango is coming up on July 4th. And they are going to be using our parking lot for some children's games. And so we are going to try to represent Christ in our community by setting up a tent in that area in our parking lot. And we're going to ask members to come and help hand out water bottles. You will see in the connection card there's a place that you can put a check mark beside if you're going to be able to help us on July 4th. So please fill that out and turn it into the connection card if you are willing and able to serve on the 4th of July. Just a reminder from our finance team, the ministries of the church continue in the summer months, so please don't forget your tithes and offerings during the summer months. And then the final thing I want to just share this morning is you're going to hear from Cheryl in a moment about our brunch coming up on Sunday the 30th, but hopefully you have received over the last couple weeks. If not, there's some cards out there in the narthex, but we have a brunch coming up on the 30th, and we want to hear from the congregation about what are your hopes, what are your dreams, what is the vision that God is putting on your heart for this time in our ministry here at First Methodist Church Odessa. You can fill that information out. You can also put that in the offering plate when the offering plates are passed along later on in worship. And so, Ms. Cheryl, I will kick it back to you for some further announcements.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The fifth Sunday brunch, and along with information of the town hall meeting, will be held on June 30th at 10 a.m. in the Fellowship Center, and the brunch will be provided. Also, I'd like to add, I'm a member of the Nathaniel Davis Daughters of the American Revolution, and we're going to have a flag retirement ceremony. So if you have a battered or frayed U.S. flag, if you'll get them to me this week, and we will replace it for y'all. Thank you. Again, thank you for worshiping with us today. We are glad you chose to worship with us. In a moment, I'm going to ask that you share Christ's peace with one another. When we gather back from sharing the peace, the music for the intro will begin, and you may be seated. Welcome home. Please stand as you are able and share Christ's peace with your neighbor.
Thank you.
drop the mic just a half an inch for that label.
Okay.
Just FYI.
Yep. Always KC that's distracting the organist or the worship leader. I know it's the consistency.
Happy Father's Day, Pastor.
Thank you. How you doing?
It's interesting, our introit this morning was surely the presence of the Lord's in this place, a familiar hymn to many of us, but as Jody, I'm going to ask Jody Wallen to come up. We had the opportunity, myself and Jody Wallen and Peggy Wallen, to attend the West Plains Annual Conference. Let me get this right. The West Plains Annual Conference, and we as West District representatives went and represented our church at annual conference. And Jody and I are going to share a few minutes with you about that. Is Joni Vincent here? Joni was one of our delegates. You heard me say that last week, but as it would be, Joni had a grandchild come into this world unexpectedly, and so Joni was unable to go, and so Peggy took her place, and so the three of us were delegates, and Jody and I are going to share what we saw and what we heard. So Jody, please share with us.
Thank you, Steve. Yeah, we were able to go. Last year, Peggy and I went before we were able to even disaffiliate. We wanted to see what it was all about, and it was a wonderful time. So this year, we got to go back as the first lay delegates of our church as part of the Global Methodist Church in the West Plains, and it was just wonderful. It was very similar to last year. I've been to probably over 25 annual conferences over my lifetime, maybe closer to 35 or 40 in our previous denomination. And I can tell you that the Global Methodist Church annual conferences are totally different. It's 95% worship and praise and listening to the Word of God and about 20 minutes of business. And all of the business... there was like three or four items of business. They explained it. He said, is there anyone that needs to speak each time? No one ever got up and argued about a thing. Everything passed unanimously. It was just the most wonderful time of worship. The mission of the Global Methodist Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ who worship passionately, love extravagantly, and witness boldly. And yesterday and the day before, they concentrated on that middle one. What does it look like to love extravagantly? So everything that was said, everything that was done, the music was all about worshiping with your whole heart and your whole soul, knowing that Jesus Christ is the answer There is no other answer. We don't have an answer to help people. We offer them Jesus Christ. And so that whole thing was concentrated on that. President Pro Tem, Mike Schaefer, oversaw everything. We were able to visit with him and Les Hall, our presiding elder, and other people. I was able to meet with Sid Strebeck a little bit. Sid used to be the lay speaker, the lay leader for the United Methodist Church in the New Mexico Annual Conference. He came over to the Global Conference and is now one of the global representatives of the West Plains. He will be going to the Global General Conference as a representative. And he was just a delight to visit with. The first day we just had a welcome by the bishop. And then a speaker spoke, we had dinner, we had an orientation service, and then an ordination service. And in that, over 40 people were received into the Methodist Church, men and women as deacons and elders, and probably over 20 that new pastors that had transferred in from the United Methodist Church as elders into the Global Methodist Church. So we ended up with 40 more preachers day before yesterday as new pastors within the Global Methodist Church. And that was a great joy, not only for them, but for us as well. Then Saturday, we had check-in, we had a welcome, we had a wonderful speaker from Asbury Seminary. One of the things I just wanted to highlight, and I take a little point of pride here, they had what was called the TED speakers, and this had to do with this loving extravagantly. And some people came up and talked about some of the missions that their church had done over the years to love on people and help people. And one speaker was Julie Maupin. She's the daughter of a good friend of mine from Groover. She grew up in Groover. Her daughter is number 20 on the Texas Tech Lady Raiders basketball team. Bailey Maupin, she's a fabulous basketball player. And Julie helped organize and raise over $100,000 and has already built more than two new homes, gave food, diapers, all kinds of things to the homeless. Over 100 people in the Fritch, Texas area, that's around Lake Meredith, up around Borger. That she was a school teacher there for years, and so she knew a lot of people. She helped raise over $100,000 to help those people in the Fritch area. Over 100,000 acres were burnt there, and of course, it was the largest fire in Texas history. Over 1 million acres burned up in that grass fire. So just stories like that that were heartwarming and meaningful. We met old friends and had wonderful worship that was led by the Abilene worship team, the Abilene Wiley Methodist Church. And some of you remember Jack Lambert, perhaps. Jack started with me years ago on Walk to Emmaus. We've probably worked over 10 Walk to Emmaus together. He was my bass player when we started the contemporary service. He was on that worship team, so we got to reconnect. It was just a wonderful time. And I'll quit talking, Steve, and let you come up. Have the other 3 minutes.
I had the hook ready. I had the hook ready. I was going to pull it out. No, we did have a blessed time. I want to share a couple things. I'm gonna share something that Peggy and Jody did not hear. When Cynthia and I were in the clergy session that began the annual conference, we heard from Bishop Scott Jones. And of course, many in the Global Methodist Church have experiences over the last couple years that have been challenging and difficult. And we are in a new season of ministry in the Methodist Church. And one of the things the bishop wanted to remind us was of that. And he shared with us from chapter 43, verses 18 and 19, would say this: "Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland." Just a reminder to us, we all have our history, we all have our baggage maybe from coming through the disaffiliation process, but we move beyond that. We're moving into a new season and a new future in this denomination and who we are as a local church. So let's be mindful of that. A couple things I want to share. We had a speaker with us that some of you may have heard of before. Maybe you've read his books, but Dr. Kevin Watson was there. And Kevin writes a lot about early Methodism, especially as it relates to spiritual growth, as it relates to the class meetings and the band meetings that early Methodists used to have. And so one of the things that was reiterated to us over and again through Kevin Watson's teaching and preaching was that there is a distinction between evangelism and discipleship. You know, we don't go out into the community and we try to disciple those who do not yet know Jesus. We just go out there to evangelize, to love on them, to share the news of Jesus Christ. And once folks are saying yes to Jesus, then we have that opportunity to disciple them, to grow in their faith. And what you need to hear is that as part of early Methodism, there were small groups known as bands and classes. I know we have small groups that meet here on Sunday school time, just in the hour from now. But we also will have other groups, class meetings, bands, life groups, whatever we want to call them. But it's important that we have opportunities and places for people to plug in and to grow in their faith. Want to just let everybody know that Mike Schaefer, if you heard of his name, Reverend Mike Schaefer, he is the president pro tem of our annual conference, the West Plains Annual Conference. He has accepted the job as the Connectional Operations Officer for the entire Global Methodist Church. He assumes those responsibilities on August 15th, and our Bishop Scott Jones has said we hope to know who our new leader in our conference will be by July 15th, so just a month from today. And then also want to let us know that as a part of our connection to the Global Methodist Church, churches have what we've called in the past apportionments or connectional mission giving that we give to the Global Church. It's a little different in the Global Methodist Church. We have a percentage we're supposed to pay, but we're not mandated. We don't get bills in the mail for that. But we have voluntarily, since the very beginning of becoming a Global Methodist Church, we have sent in our percentage, if you will. And what was voted on yesterday in our finance portion of the meeting was that the 4% of our operational income, which is our tie to the denomination, will remain the same next year in 2025. So that's important for us to know. And then I'll leave it with this. This is how Bishop Scott Jones closed our worship service yesterday. He said, do these three things, churches, and all will be okay. He said, put Jesus first, yield, and say yes to God. If we do those things, God will be with us, and we will be successful in our endeavors together as individuals, as a church family. And now, we come to the time when we open in prayer. And before I ask us to bow our heads and go to God in prayer, I just want to walk over here. And we have a lovely, very talented organist and pianist, Shari. And you're going to hear her play in just a few moments. But you will not hear her play in person next week because Shari is having, is it safe to say, a much-awaited surgery. So she's thankful. Yay! She has to have surgery. But this is to hopefully heal her so she'll be able to do all the wonderful things she wants to do. So Shari will not be with us after today for several weeks, however long that recovery process is, but you will be able to hear her music because a couple weeks ago, Shari and Kenneth and all the others who helped made some recordings of her playing. So you will hear her next week. But please keep Shari and her family in your prayers as she has this surgery and as she recovers. And we'll probably see her in worship in a few weeks, and she'll worship with us as we all together listen to her play. So with that in mind, would you bow your heads as we go to Almighty God in prayer? Oh, good and gracious God, we thank you, God, that you are a benevolent and loving and merciful God, that you not only create us, not only have you redeemed us in Christ, but through your Holy Spirit, Lord, you sustain us and guide us and direct us every single day. Lord, as our Creator, you know everything about us. You know everything about everyone, because, Lord, again, you are our Creator. And, Lord, one of the things we know about you is you're a God who loves to hear from your children, to hear our concerns, to hear our cries, to hear our thanks and praise. And so, Lord, in this time, in this place, we pause so we can lift aloud to you and to one another, so we can share our praises, so we can share our concerns with one another and you. So, Lord, as we lift these praises and these concerns up, we respond with, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear these prayers we offer today. Lord, hear our prayer. 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 Almighty and gracious God, Lord, we give thanks that you've received our prayers. And Lord, we know that sometimes we say prayers one on top of one another, and so maybe we don't hear, but Lord, your ears are different than ours, and we know, Lord, that you hear everything, even the prayers that we left unspoken, that we lifted to you silently. Lord, we know that you heard those prayers as well. And so, Lord, we thank you for receiving those prayers. We pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts and minds any answers, any responses, Lord, that we were longing and needed from you. We pray, Lord, that we would feel your presence in our hearts and our lives, and Lord, that we would share that love both near and far. And now, Lord, as your people, as your children, we pray the prayer that your son Jesus taught us so long ago to pray and sang, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
If you'll please stand as you are able and join responsively in the call to worship. Come bless the Lord with me, for the Lord is like a father to his children, compassionate, merciful, filled with endless love. Our Heavenly Father forgives our sins and heals the sickness inside of us. Our God surrounds us with love and mercy and fills our lives with good things. Let us worship God together. Amen.
Lead on, O King Eternal, the day of march has come. Henceforth in fields of conquest thy tents shall be our home. Through days of preparation thy grace has made us strong. And now, O King Eternal, we lift our battle song. Lead on, O King Eternal, our sins' fierce war shall cease, and holiness shall whisper the sweet Amen of peace. For not with swords loud clashing, nor all of stirring drums, with deeds of love and mercy the heavenly kingdom comes. Lead on, O King Eternal, we follow not with fears, for gladness breaks like morning where'er thy face appears. knees. Thy cross is lifted o'er us. We journey in its light. The crown awaits, the conquest. Lead on, O God of might.
Amen. Y'all sound good this morning, choir and the congregation. You may be seated, unless you're one of the children. And I see Miss Janice coming. And I see KC coming, maybe. Come on, Josiah, you gonna come with us today? He says, nope, I'm gonna stay with Mom this morning. That's okay. We love you. Come on, Z. Come on, Zachariah. He's running. You may not see him. He's running so fast. Come on. You know, I wasn't very thoughtful, and I did not get you, Mike, because I forgot. But here. No.
Okay, very good. Good morning. Are we good? All right, I got a question for you today. What does it mean to have an open heart? What? An antenna? What if I talk? Oh, where am I? I don't know this. There you go. All right, an open heart. What does it mean to have an open heart? Okay, Steve, you might have to grab Z there. Okay, Miss Emma, what does an open heart mean?
An open heart means like you're always trying to tell others you're nice, you're trying to stop the fight.
All right, very good. All right, that means open heart means you're open to God. That means you are willing to listen to Him. You go to Him for help. You're just, He's always there for you, right? Well, in today, well, I thought in today's scripture, but today, or sometime, we're going to, Paul and Silas are going to meet a lady named Lydia. Okay, you are. Okay. We're going to talk about Lydia today. Now, Lydia, she was a God-fearing woman. That means that she knew God. She followed her life, followed God. She did what she was supposed to, but she didn't know Jesus. And so Paul and Silas came to visit her town, and Paul, she had such an open heart that when Paul told her about God, she received the gospel and she was baptized. And then you know what she did? She invited everybody to her house. They came to her house and they continued to talk about Jesus and learn about Jesus. But she listened and had an open heart and she believed. And she believed. So it's important that we have an open heart. Now, one thing we can do to have an open heart is to serve God, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So today, we're going to talk about, we're going to have our first mission trip this week. I'm very excited about our first mission trip that we have. We are going to go out to the courtyards, which is a place where assisted people live that need a little help. And we are going to go out there and we are going to go exercise with them and talk with them. No. Yay, we're excited. It's going to be on Wednesday. I have a little postcard. Parents, if anybody has somebody they want to invite on our mission trip, we have information for them. But that is part. We're going to go out. We're going to serve cookies and lemonade, and we're going to fellowship with them, and we're going to talk to them, and we're just going to be with them. And they love it when people come to see them, especially young people. So I'm very, very excited. And in the meantime, if we have some trash or whatever, Miss Cassandra, who is the director out there, needs us to do, she's going to find us some jobs to do also. So it's important that we have an open heart, that we listen to God, we follow His will, and that we also know that He is there to go with us, and He will always be there with us. So let's bow our heads, and let's have our prayer. Just repeat after me. Dear Lord, help us to open our hearts so that we can understand what You are trying to teach us. We love You and want to serve You. Amen. All right.
And as Miss Janice said, we have more cards available, so maybe your child is not here today. Maybe your grandchild is not here today. reach out to Miss Janice, and she will tell you all about it and make arrangements so they can be here. And as our children go to children time or back to their seats, it's now time for our offertory prayer, Miss Cheryl.
Will the ushers please come forward, and congregation, please join us in the offertory prayer. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can always trust in you. You are an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you this offering today. With it, we worship you and give our whole selves to you. Please now take it and use it for building your kingdom and your glory. Extend and multiply its reach and influence, we pray. May it be a great blessing to many. We ask all this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power of bliss. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit.
Please remain standing for the scripture reading from the book of Acts, chapter 16, verses 1 through 5. Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was Jewish and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The believers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. Paul wanted to take him along on the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area. For they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they traveled from town to town, they delivered the decisions reached by the apostles and elders in Jerusalem for the people to obey. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and grew daily in numbers. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
This morning we are continuing in the book of Acts, which we've been in for the last several weeks. And as we continue in the book of Acts, I just got to start off by saying I think Christians in general, people who love God and who love neighbor, generally speaking, we care about other people that we know about. We care about people in our circle of influence. We care about our family members. We care about our friends. We care about our business associates. We care about the people we meet in the grocery store. We want good for them. And we know inherently, because we've been talking about it over and over again, and we do so again today, that God has put a call on each of our lives to share the good news of Jesus Christ. We may call that evangelism, we may call it sharing our story, but each and every one of us are called by our Savior, called to be witnesses, to be conveyors of the good news of Jesus Christ, both in our circle of influence and beyond. And even though I think that we all, generally speaking, want to do this, we want to be faithful to the Lord, we want to share the good news with people that God places in our path, but I think sometimes we build this process up. Again, whether you want to call it evangelism, you want to call it sharing the gospel, you want to call it sharing your story, we get our minds wrapped up and make it so complicated. And I think oftentimes the reason we do that is because we think it's all up to us. And ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, it is not all up to us. We have a role. We have a part to play. But we only have a small part to play in that process we might call disciple making or the salvation process. We have a part to play in it, but we only have one part to play. And so part of what I think is important is we know what our part is and we know what our part is not. And I've always found that Acts chapter 16 have some very helpful hints in there that help us to know how we can live more fully into our God-given calling of sharing the news both near and far. But before I jump into the text, I want to do as we've done throughout the rest of our time in the book of Acts. I want you to join your voices with mine as we offer the prayer before the message. We're going to be offering the words of the prayer that is in that song, Spirit of the Living God. And that chorus is printed in your bulletin. So I invite you to join your voice with mine as we pray. Spirit of the Living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Amen. Before I get to chapter 16, I want to just catch us up, because last week we were in chapter 13, and of course in chapter 13 we see Paul goes on his first missionary journey. And that journey continues in chapter 14 until it comes to its conclusion. Then after that, chapter 15 is a very important chapter. It goes over all the details of what was known as the Jerusalem Council. A group of early brothers and sisters in the Christian faith came together in Jerusalem to talk about what was required for salvation. What was it required that you needed to become a Jewish person first before becoming a Christian? And so there were a lot of things associated with that. But at the Jerusalem Council, it was decided once and for all that salvation is grace through faith in Jesus Christ. So that meant none of the works of the law, if you will, were required for salvation. Jesus Christ only was necessary for salvation. And so that was great and good and glorious news. And one of the things I think it's important to know, especially as we come into chapter 16, one of the things that was no longer required was circumcision, the process the Jewish people went through as a part of the Mosaic Law. No longer was circumcision required. Only Jesus was required. And we're almost in chapter 16, but in chapter 15, we find at the very end of that there was a conflict between Paul and Barnabas who went on that first missionary journey together. And I love the fact that Luke does not bury that information, does not throw it under the carpet. He shares and shows that sometimes people of good faith have disagreements and problems. You know, there would not be any single problem within the church universal, or this church for that matter, were it not for us human beings. But we're all human beings. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And because of that, sometimes conflict arises in the life of the church. And so we see that Paul and Barnabas, they have a discussion about whether or not John Mark should go with them. There's a disagreement, and they go their separate ways. And we do not hear from Barnabas. again in the book of Acts. We do know from other scripture that at the end, both Paul and Barnabas and John Mark, they come back together and all is well. But for right now, going into chapter 16, they're going in different directions. Now, you've already heard Cheryl read verses 1 through 5. And as you heard, Paul is going to be going on a missionary journey again, this time to revisit, if you will, those churches that were planted on that first missionary journey. And they go a little bit about it differently. They almost go in reverse order, if you will. They don't start in the water and set sail. They stay inward, and they make their way up straight north. And so they come to the cities of Lystra and Derbe, and these are relatively insignificant cities with a small population of Jews. And they meet there a man by the name of Timothy. And it's quite likely that it's Timothy's mother and grandmother to whom Paul is referring when he writes that letter we know as 1 Timothy later. And these ladies, as we know them, the grandmother and the mother of Timothy, they come to know Christ on that first missionary journey. And as they're making their way back, now Timothy the son and grandson, is also a believer as well. Now, Timothy's mother was Jewish and his father was Greek. And according to the Jewish tradition, the children would follow the religion of the mother, which, of course, in this case, would be Jewish. But according to the Greek tradition, you would follow the father's religion. And so probably in Timothy's case, the father decided that his son was not going to be circumcised, and his son, therefore, was not. Now, remember, as we come into this 16th chapter of Acts, Paul and now his new friend, Silas, they're going. They're going to go over and they're going to take the gospel of Jesus Christ and go back to those churches, and they're going to help them know once and for all that you don't have to follow the Mosaic law. You do not have to be circumcised. And so he tells Timothy, hey, you need to be circumcised. And so we wonder about that and wonder, why is that the case? Now remember, according to the text that Cheryl read, that we knew that there are legalistic Jews in the communities to which Paul is sharing the gospel, in which Timothy is sharing the gospel. So he knows that there's going to be some legalistic Jews that are going to be there saying that even though the Jerusalem Council has said you don't need to be circumcised, there are going to be some of these legalistic Jews who are going to be saying, yes, you need to be circumcised. And so he knows there are going to be problems and consequences in the fact that Timothy is not circumcised. And so Timothy is circumcised. And I don't want to go into a lot of great detail, but let me just say that was not just some small event. It's one thing to be circumcised as an infant child when you're in the hospital. It is a completely different thing, I would guess, to be circumcised as an adult male. You may remember in the Old Testament, at Shechem, there was a whole group of people when they crossed over. It was this big adult circumcision, and they were left unable to move for days. But I think part of what we glean from these first five verses in Acts chapter 16 is we remember that Paul and Timothy were putting the needs of others above their own selves. Why have an obstacle to God's grace being that you are not circumcised? And so they take that excuse, that reason away from all those whom they're being sent to preach the gospel to. We have to remember it's not about, you know, our freedoms and what we're able to do. We can be obedient slaves to Christ. We can be obedient to what God calls us to do and help share the love of God with others. But we need to be careful. We need to make sure that we don't put any obstacles, put any things in the way of other people that would help them or hinder them, I should say, from hearing the gospel. Now, I know that there are men out there who are saying, well, this does not apply to me because I was circumcised a long time ago. There are women out there saying, thank goodness that doesn't apply to me. Let me try to put it into a 21st century perspective, since maybe circumcision is not a thing for us. Let me just say, maybe you are a person who likes a glass of wine after dinner. I'm not going to stand up here and say there's something wrong with that. However, if you are going to have a conversation with your brother-in-law who may be going through a difficult time and may be struggling with alcohol, maybe you shouldn't take him to the bar to have a conversation about your faith. Again, we need to be mindful of what other people are experiencing and what's going on in their life. You know, there are people that you may encounter that, you know, you want them to come to church. You know that they need the love of Jesus Christ in their hearts and their minds. You know that would make a significant difference in their life. And you try to get them to church, and you try to get them to church, and they won't. Well, maybe we need to try a different approach. Maybe you're hosting a small group at your house, and you invite them into your kitchen to have snacks and talk about life. Maybe we need to rethink how we do things. Now, I'm going to go from preaching to meddling. You know, we have a worship service here, and every single Sunday we have traditional music. You know, we've had contemporary music in the past, but maybe sometime in our future, maybe we need to think about having more contemporary music as part of this service or another service we do. And some of you may go, oh my goodness, Pastor, I love traditional music. Everything else is no good. I can tell you, I can handle listening to a song that may be not my favorite song if it's going to help bring someone else to Christ. We need to remember, it's not about me. It's not about you. It's about the people who are not yet here. I want to move on because I think I'm going to blame it on Jody. Jody took way too long talking about annual conference. And yes, I know I did too. But I want to move along, and I want to move on to verses 5 through 10. And I think Miss Trish will have it on the screen. If I can open my glasses and my Bible, I will join there with you. As you see on the screen, Paul and his companions traveled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them, so they passed by Mysia and went to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready and wants to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. From Troas, we put out to sea and sailed straight for Samothrace. And the next day, we went on to Neapolis. From there, we traveled to Philippi, a Roman colony and the leading city of that district of Macedonia, and we stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate to the river, where we expected to find a place of prayer. We sat down and began to speak to the women who had gathered there. One of those listening was a woman from the city of Thyatira named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth. She was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message, and when she and the members of her household were baptized, she invited us to her home. "If you consider me a believer in the Lord," she said, "come and stay at my house," and she persuaded us. Amen. So, there's two sections of Scripture there, and I'm going to start with verse 6 through 10. You know, we see that Paul had an idea of where to go on the mission trip, but the Spirit of the Lord says, no, you're not to go there. Now, we don't know exactly how that was communicated to Paul. We don't know exactly why that was communicated to Paul. Maybe there were some dangers that he was not aware of that would be present if he went. But I think the important thing for us to note is that here in this time together, there was a listening to the leading of the Holy Spirit. It talks about visions in those passages, verse 6 through 10. And maybe some of you are thinking, Pastor, I've never had a vision. I've never had the Lord God speak out loud to me. And let me just say, God created you. God knows you. God knows how to reach out to you. That might be speaking to you audibly. It might be in a vision. It might be for a word from a friend or a loved one. But God knows how to speak to us. What we often do not understand, quite frankly, is how we're to stop and to listen. But obviously in this text, we see in verses 6 through 10 that in whatever way that occurred, Paul listened to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Paul did not understand why that was the case. He was very passionate in wanting to go on to where he wanted to go. But the Lord called him. And in a vision, he sees he's supposed to go to Macedonia. Now, a couple of things to note. One of the things I think is just it's important to note as we read text, when you start reading in that verse 6, Luke, who is writing this, uses the language "we." So no longer is Luke a person who is writing an account from somebody giving the information to them, Luke is a part of the missionary journey. He is writing in the text of we did this, we did that, and that we will continue for a while until he leaves that area. The other thing I think it is important to note is that this city that they wind up coming to, this city they wind up coming to was a significant city because it had a medical school there. We know that Luke was a doctor, and so maybe this is Luke's hometown in Philippi. Maybe that's where he went to med school, so maybe this is his home turf. Now, one of the things that I think, again, it's important in those verses 6 through 10 is we have to understand that God's Spirit speaks to us. And we have to figure out how to best listen to that. And I'm speaking to us as individuals and as a church who are called to go out and spread the good news of Jesus Christ. So let us listen to the voice of the Spirit. But as I come to this verse 11 through 15, as we see Paul going down to the river to meet these ladies, the first thing we have to know is that if you were to have a synagogue in a city, you had to have 10 Jewish men. Now, apparently in this place, even though it was a pretty influential city, there is no synagogue. There are no 10 men to go and to meet with and to share the gospel with. So they go out of town about a mile and a half, and sure enough, there's a river there, a body of water. And usually these places of prayer that were started were near a body of water because there were certain Jewish rituals for cleansing that required water. But Paul and his group go there, and they find these women praying. And here's Lydia. Lydia from Thyatira, she's an influential woman. She's a businesswoman. She deals in purple cloth, which is one of the most expensive cloths. And there, Paul shares the gospel with her. And it's miraculous. Not only does she come to believe, but she has her family, her servants, all those who were there, maybe other relatives, they are baptized as well. And what's really cool is the church is formed in Lydia's house. When you read the book of Philippians, to that church, that letter to the church in Philippi, you're reading about a church that was started because the Lord spoke to Lydia through Paul. And then her family, her friends were baptized and they started a church. But here's what's important to understand in that passage that we read. We may read that passage and think, oh my goodness, look at the wonderful work that Paul and his servants did. We often overlook that verse that says, the Lord opened Lydia's heart. And here's where I want to come back full circle to where I began this message with, saying that I think sometimes we overemphasize what our role as human beings are. I have never, ever in my life saved a human soul. I don't have that power. I have never been able to argue anyone into the kingdom of God. I've never been able to persuade one into the kingdom of God because that's not my role. You know, you may have thought you would come one Sunday without hearing me read Acts chapter 1, verse 8. If you thought that, you were not correct. Because I want to share again with you Acts chapter 1, verse 8 that says this. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria to the ends of the earth. Paul starts on this missionary journey. Timothy gives us an example about it's not all about him. It's about those to whom God is reaching. So we need to be careful. We need to be strategic. We need to be thoughtful when we're engaging with others so we don't put any obstacles in the way from them coming to know Jesus Christ. We need to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit that's speaking to our hearts, to our minds, maybe speaking audibly to us, maybe coming to us in a vision. The way God speaks to me and the way God speaks to you are probably completely different because we're different creations of His handiwork. So we need to listen to the Holy Spirit and be mindful of that. But the bottom line is we also need to remember, as God has planned, as God has ordained, we, brothers and sisters in Christ, those who call ourselves Christians, who place our faith and trust in Him, we have a part in this salvation process. And our job, whether we want to call it evangelism or sharing the gospel or witnessing, whatever we want to call it, our job is to go and just share what we already know about. I am not an expert in Ronnie Neal's life, nor am I an expert in Casey People's life. I'm not sure I'm an expert in my life, but I know what I'm going through. I don't know what they're going through, and I don't know what any of you are going through and what the Lord is saying to you, but God does. And all we have to do is to be obedient, to be witnesses, to share the message. And some days, when I talk about going out and evangelizing, when I talk about sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, you know, again, be attentive to the listening. Sometimes we place it upon ourselves that we've got it too much. Maybe I'm just going to pick on KC and Ronnie some more. Maybe KC is having challenges in his life and he needs to know the Lord, and Ronnie knows that. He sees that in KC, and so he wants to reach out and help him. That may not mean Ronnie's going to sit down with KC and say, hey, do you know if you die tonight, do you know where you're going to go? He's just going to have a conversation with him. Sometimes the best way we can witness our love for Jesus Christ is just listening. How often in our world do we find people not listening? You know, Kimberly might come up to me and say, hey, how are you doing? And before I can even begin to start talking and sharing the depth of my heart, what's going on, maybe Kimberly's going to walk away because she really doesn't want to know what I think. She's just asking a question. This is all hypothetical. Okay. But my point is, sometimes we make it too difficult. We just need to be obedient and to be present. And sometimes that's just sitting beside somebody, holding their hand, loving on them, saying, I'll be here with you. We don't have to have all the answers. I, as your pastor, I'll stand before you right now and say, there's a lot of stuff I don't know. And I am not afraid to say, I don't know. I'm not the Lord, and neither are any of you in this room. But we know who the Lord is. We know what we're called to do. We know whose we are and what we're called to do. I was going to say amen, but Ronnie already beat it. So if you didn't hear it, say it again louder, Ronnie.
Amen.
And everybody else says?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. You know, I love as the Spirit of God weaves things together, because, you know, as I come to the end of the service and I look at what our sending forth song, oh my goodness, it fits in wonderfully about witnessing. It says, we have a story to tell the nations. No matter who you are, no matter what your age, no matter how long you have been a follower of Christ, God has a plan for you and God has a call on your life. I, you, y'all, all of us have a story to tell the nations. And I'll be quiet so Kennison can say, please stand and rise as we sing our closing song, or whatever you want to say.
Please stand and rise as we sing our closing song. We have a story to tell the nations, verse 1, please.
Story to tell of the nations that shall turn their hearts to the light. A story of truth and mercy, a story to peace and light, a story of peace and light. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light.
I think I have to share with y'all, and I can't find my notes. I know one important thing. Remember, it's Father's Day, and we have donuts for Dad. So go around the corner and get a donut. And I guess the final thing I have to say is, just like these children are modeling for us, taking out the light of Christ into the world, we also have the light of Christ in our hearts, and we're taking it out into the world. In all of our jobs is equally important. So now receive this closing prayer as our acolytes take the flame of Christ out. Almighty and gracious God, may your Spirit burn within us brightly so that we may take it out in the world, that we might shine brightly and your kingdom might grow and flourish and do all the things, Lord, that you're calling us to do today, tomorrow, and all the future tomorrows. And all God's people who were excited said,
amen.
Amen.